Today we are going to start with the inequality properties of definite integrals. Okay. So these properties are the most favorite ones when it comes to competitive exams, because many times this requires a bit of reverse engineering, thinking backwards. Okay, and that's what makes this topic slightly challenging as compared to the normal properties. So let us get started with the very first property. So let's say there is a function f of x, okay, which is basically greater than a function g of x and lesser than or equal to a function, let's say h of x, okay, for all x belonging to an interval a comma b. And of course, these all functions are integrable as well. And all these functions, f of x, g of x, h of x, are integrable in the interval a to b. Okay. So if three functions f, g, and h satisfy this condition, okay, then please note down, even their definite integrals between a to b will also satisfy the same condition. That means integral of g of x from a to b will be lesser than or equal to integral of f of x from a to b will be lesser than or equal to integral of h of x from a to b. Okay. Now, what is the reason for this property? The reason for this property is very simple to understand from the geometrical interpretation of definite integrals. No idea, Prakul, JE will happen during January or after the boards. We are also eagerly waiting for it. Okay, but I have, if you ask my speculation, when will the JE main first phase happen? I personally feel, and many of my colleagues who are in teaching field, they believe that it cannot happen earlier than February end. Okay, that is what is my gut feeling. I may be wrong. People may be wrong. It all depends upon whether National Testing Agency surprises us. Okay. Yes, the proof is very simple. If you see, I'm just taking a case where all these functions are positive, but they need not be all positive. So if your f of x function is like this, okay, g of x function is maybe like something like this. Okay, and let's say h of x function is something like this. Okay, so as you can see in this interval from a to b, let me just make the a to b interval. So this is your a and this is your b. So in your a to b interval, your f of x is between this is your f of x, this is your g of x, and let me change the color of the pen to the same color as the graph has been drawn. This is your h of x. Okay, so even this area, let's talk about the area or the algebraic area between the function f of x and the x-axis. This will be more than this white area. Let me shade it in vertical stripes. And this will be lesser than this blue area, which I'm shading with horizontal stripes. Okay, so it's very obvious that the algebraic area, so let's say I call this area to be A2, I call this area to be A3, and I call this area to be A1. Okay, algebraic area. So A1 will be between A2 to A3. Okay, that's the main reason for this particular property. Now, many a times you will get a question where you will be just given an integral, of course, with the limits, and the question setter will ask you that this integral lies between which values. So it may be possible that this property is helping you to solve that particular scenario. I think today morning, Aditya asked me a question of the same type, isn't it? So all this falls under this type of question. And that questions cannot be solved without looking at the options. Okay. So whenever you are asking such a question that this integral lies between which values, okay, you should always show the option clearly to the person whom you are asking the question, because it depends upon the option also, because it requires reverse engineering. It is not that, you know, you will always be able to figure out between which two functions a given function lies so that you can link their integrals with each other. It requires a bit of reverse engineering. It requires a bit of backward tracking. Okay. Let's take a question on the same. Let's take a very simple question on the same. I'll take a couple of questions for you all. Let's say I want you to prove. So I'm giving it as a prove that question so that you can always, you know, figure out what is the required function. So prove that the integral of 1 by under root of 1 minus x to the power 2n, where n is a quantity greater than or equal to 1, is always between half to pi by 6. Is always between half to pi by 6, and the limits of integration is 0 to half. Okay. Now you can solve this question only when this information is provided to you directly or indirectly via options, right? So looking at the options only, you can take a call, right? Now think what you can do in order to prove this. It's not a rocket science. Just have a good look at what you have been provided. Pi by 6, half. Okay, so Kshitij has, you know, done a small breakthrough. Yes, Kshitij, you are on the right track. Just justify it. No, you don't have to solve the integral, Gayatri. Don't get this question wrong. They're not asking you to solve this integral. They're asking you to, you know, bound the answer of this integral. Right, Aditya. Think about that. Yes. Very good. So most of you have done a good job on this. See, let us look at the scenario. If your n is greater than or equal to 1, okay, and your x is supposed to be a fraction, okay, x is somewhere between 0 to half. Okay, you can keep open integral 0 to half. Okay, do you all agree that if x is a fraction and you raise it to a power 2 and you raise it to the power of 2n, n being more than 1, let's say greater than or equal to 1, which one will be more or which one will be less out of the two? Which inequality sign I should put? X square will be more or x to the power 2n will be more? X square will be more, right? So can I say this will be greater than? Okay. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to multiply with a minus sign on both the sides of the inequality. And we all know that when you multiply with a minus sign with on both the sides of the inequality switches, correct? Yes or no? Hey, Shadda. If x is a fraction, the higher the power, the lesser will be the value. No, half to the power 3 is more or half to the power 2 is more? Half to the power 2 is more, no? Correct. So 2 to the power n will be greater than or equal to 2, right? So half to the power 2, sorry, x to the power 2n will be lesser than x to the power 2, right? Okay. If I add a 1, that should not affect the inequality sign, correct? If I take the under root, that should not affect the inequality sign. Correct? And can I also say that this quantity will be lesser than or equal to 1 also? Because you're subtracting some positive quantity from 1. Okay. And of course, taking the under root. So that will decrease the value. And it 1 will be more than this. Correct? So everybody agrees with this particular scenario. Okay. Now, if you reciprocate everything, again, the inequality will switch. Okay. Now, from where did I get this idea? Because pi by 6 comes when you are trying to put your upper and the lower limits in this, isn't it? That only gives you pi by 6. And sine inverse x comes from the integration of 1 by under root 1, my 1 by under root 1 minus x square. So I did a backtracking. I did a reverse engineering to figure out this function from this data that was provided to me. And of course, this comes from the integration of 1 from 0 to half. Okay. So all these things are like acting like your hints in the question. It cannot be blindly solved. Remember, options have to be looked at. Then only you can solve this question. Okay. Now, once you have figured out that there is a function which is lying between two functions, let me call them as g of x and h of x. Okay. Then their integral will also satisfy the same property. That means integral of the function from a to b will also be more than integral of g of x from a to b. And this in turn will be lesser than integral of h of x from a to b. Okay. In short, the given integral, which I'm calling it as I, will be greater than integral of 1 from 0 to half, will be lesser than equal to integral of 1 by under root 1 minus x square from 0 to half. So this gives us a half. And this, as I already told you, this is sine inverse x 0 to half. That gives you pi by 6. And there you go. Done. Is it fine? So you need to act as per the options provided to you. And by the way, I would request people who are really serious about cracking JE Main, JE Advance, or any competitive exam, please ring up one of the guys. Let's say if you are from NPS Indranagar, ring up Ruchir Parikh. We'll be more than happy to share his number with you. Of course, after his permission only, because he would be getting calls from so many places. And NPS Rajaji Nagar, please speak to Tripan. Okay. NPS HSR people, I think you would be knowing Ruchir Singh. Okay, Ruchir Singh. Speak to him and ask him. Please get the information about the final months of your preparation, because these people have put in their heart and soul. Almost 16, 17 hours of study they were doing in the last few months, as what I knew from them. Okay. Speak to them. They will tell you how to, balance out things. If you hear from me, you'll think sir is repeating the same thing. In one day. Yes. In one day, 16, 17 hours of study they were putting in. Right. Correct, Kshitij. Okay. Anyways, so let's take a few more questions based on this property. So I will not take a lot of your time. Let's take this question. Let I1 be an integral, which is sine x by x. Okay, this integral is from pi by 6 to pi by 3. Okay, I2 be an integral, which is sine of sine x by sine x. This integral is also from pi by 6 to pi by 3. And I3 is another integral, which is sine of tan x by tan x. Okay. This is also from pi by 6 to pi by 3. Okay. Now, which of the following options are correct? Pick the right options. Okay. Choose the correct option. Option number A. I1 is more than I2 is more than I3. Option number B, I3 is more than I2 is more than I1. Option number C, I2 is more than I1 and I1 is more than I3. Okay. And option number D, I1 is more than I3 is more than I2. If you want, I can put the polling option on for you all. Think carefully and then solve. So here you need not evaluate these integrals individually. Maybe you will not be able to do that also, correct? So you need to just compare these integrals. depending upon the property that you have just now seen. Oh, sorry, I'm so sorry, Raghav, it's 5/6 to 5/3 on, sorry, slip off there. So I've got a response, very good. Good, good, good. 9 of you have responded. Almost 2.5 minutes. Yes, can we solve this poll in the next 30 seconds? 16 of you, I could see you have participated in the poll. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so I could see good, good. I could see more than 50% participation. However, I was expecting more than 80. Most of you have gone with option number C, but even D is closer. Some of you have said D is the right option. Most of you have said C is the right option. Okay, let's discuss it out. See, first of all, if you see the nature of the integrands involved are of the nature sine something by something, isn't it? Sine x by x, sine x by sine x, or sine of tan x by tan x. Okay. So first you need to ask yourself, what kind of a function is sine x by x? Now, if you remember when we did our limits topic, we had seen that the graph of sine x by x is a ripple like this. And of course, there is a hole here at zero. Okay. This place is pi because, okay. So between pi by 6 to pi by 3, the function is a decreasing function. So this function is a decreasing function in the interval pi by 6 to pi by 3, correct? Yes or no? Decreasing function means more the input, lesser is the value, isn't it? Yes or no? So can I say in place of x, if I put a sine x, so which will have more value? Sine x by x will have more value, or sine of sine x by sine x will have more value? Now you will say, sir, sine x has a lesser value as compared to x in that interval pi by 6 to pi by 3, isn't it? So pi by 6 to pi by 3, x graph is above sine x graph. You can check it out. Yes or no? So which of the two has more input? This one has more input. So this value will be lesser, isn't it? Right? So that means this guy will be more. Agreed, everybody? Because sine x has a lesser value as compared to x in the interval pi by 6 to pi by 3, isn't it? So more the input, lesser will be the value of the function because it's a decreasing function. Isn't it? Decreasing function has a tendency that if you put more inputs to it, it will fall down, isn't it? Means larger input, lesser output. Similarly, can I say that sine of tan x by tan x will be lesser than sine of x by x? Why? Because tan x has more value as compared to x in the interval pi by 6 to pi by 3. Correct? So tan x graph supersedes, or basically it's above the graph of y equal to x. Correct? So in light of this, can I make an inequality over here stating that sine x by x will be greater than equal to sine tan x by tan x will be greater than sine x by sine x. So is everybody fine with this inequality between the integrands involved? Okay. So using the property, we can say that so will be the integral also. So if you integrate it from pi by 6 to pi by 3, okay, this integral will be more than integral of sine of tan x by tan x. And in turn, this will be lesser than integral of sine of sine x by sine x. Okay. In short, what I want to say is I1 is in middle, I2 is the greatest. So this is your I2, this is your I1, and this is your I3. So wherever the order says I2 more than I1, more than I3. I2 more than I1, more than I3. Yes. So this inequality will be taken into consideration. Is this fine? However, all these inequalities are actually pure inequalities, other than you take a limiting case. Yeah. But limiting case happens at zero, which is not in the interval. So you may do away with the impure inequality and state a pure inequality as well. That's also fine. Is it okay? Any questions, any concerns with respect to the solution of this problem? Okay, so we'll take one more last question on this property and we'll move on to another one. There are four integrals which I'm going to give you: I1, I2, I3, I4. Okay. Please note down these four integrals. The first integral is integral of 2 to the power x square from 0 to 1. Second integral is 2 to the power x cube from 0 to 1. Third integral is integral of 2 to the power x square from 1 to 2. And fourth integral is integral of 2 to the power x cube from 1 to 2. Okay. You need to state true or false for the following statement, which I'm going to write. Okay. Statement A says I1 is more than I2. Okay. Statement B says I2 is more than I1. Statement C says I3 is more than I4. And statement D says I3 is less than I4. In fact, if you answer one of them, the other one will automatically get addressed. So let us start with A. Put your response like this. A, true or false, whatever you feel like. Okay. and try to give all your answers in one go. Put A, B, C, D, and next to it, you put your true, false, whatever you feel it's going to be working out there. Oh, yeah, yeah. You can also put, let's say, TFFT, something like this, whatever. I mean, the first one is automatically for A, second one for B, third one for C, like that also you can put. Very simple. I will not be giving you more than 1 minute for this. This is a touch and go question. Very good. Kinshuk, Archit, Kiran, very good. Vaibhav Manikar, very good. Kshitij, was that your answer or you still have to give your answer? Okay, okay. Kiran, common sense. These two cannot be at the same parity. Both cannot be true or both cannot be false simultaneously. Correct? Thoda socho yaar. Think. Okay. Okay, Aditi. Okay, Charan. Yes, last 30 seconds. I want everybody to participate. Come on. Should I name people? Gaurav, your participation has gone down. Arjun. Himanshu. Pratik. Shambo. Yes, come on. Yes. Okay. Should we discuss it now? Very good, Pratik. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much for responding. See, it's very obvious between I1 and I2. See, remember, x is between 0 to 1, right? So x square will have more value than x cube, correct? So 2 to the power x square will have more value than 2 to the power x cube, correct? So obviously, I2 will have a lesser value than I1. So I1 will be more than I2. So this option is a true option. Okay, so by default, this will become false, right? But what is the case between I3 and I4? When your x is between 1 to 2, please note that this time x square will be lesser than x cube. That means 2 to the power x square will be lesser than 2 to the power x cube. Okay, in that case, I4 will be more than I3. So this will be true. And this will, let me write it in white. This will be true and this will automatically become false. So the answer here is TFFT. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns that you have here, please let me know. Okay. Now the previous property, I'm going to slightly extend it and make the next property for you. So I'm going to now change the slide. If you have any question with respect to solution of this problem, do let me know. Okay. So property number two, instead of sandwiching a function between two given functions, okay, I'm basically trying to scale up the property and saying that if there is a function, okay, f of x, which has a global minima equal to small m in the interval a to b and has a global maxima equal to capital M in the interval A to B. Okay. In short, what I'm trying to say here is that your function f of x is between small m and capital M. Okay. So you need not always figure out the two functions in between which your function f of x lies. Okay, so there may be a case, there may be a type of a problem which can be solved even by this property as well. So if you realize that a function has a global minima of small m in the interval a to b and a global maxima of capital M in the interval a to b, so treat as if your small m is like your g of x of the previous property and your capital M is like your h of x of the previous property. So just like the previous property, you can call it as an extension of the previous property also. The integral of the function will basically lie between these values. Okay. Now these values have come from where? Very simple. This value is nothing but it is the integral of m from a to b. That's it. M being a constant. So basically it becomes m times b minus a. And this has come from integral of capital M from a to b. So again, capital M is a constant. So it becomes capital M times a minus b. Exactly. Exactly, Raghav. Yes. Okay. So I think today there was a question from Aditya. Aditya, I was asking integral of 1 by ln x, right, Aditya? I'm not very sure about the options because you had not given me the options completely. Okay. So now here, if you see 1 by ln x function, okay. This function is a decreasing function in 2 to 3 interval. If you differentiate it, what do you get? If you differentiate, you get 1 by ln x the whole square into 1 by x. So in the interval 2 to 3, in the interval 2 to 3, 1 by ln x function is decreasing because if you see the derivative is going to be negative. Okay, this is a negative quantity, correct? That means the function will have a global minima at 2, at 3 and global maxima at 2. That means 1 by ln x function is between 1 by ln 3 and 1 by ln 2. Correct? Or is it the other way around? It's a decreasing function. So its highest value will be at 2 and least value will be at 3. Correct. So I can say that integral of 1 by ln x dx will lie somewhere between 1 by ln 3, 3 minus 2, which is actually a 1, and 1 by ln 2, 3 minus 2, which is actually a 1 again. So this answer will lie between 1 by ln 3 and 1 by ln 2. I hope most of you are already aware of these values. If not, you should always keep in mind. Who will tell me ln 3 value? ln 3. Nah. You need to remember some value. ln 2, ln 3, ln 5, etc. ln 3 value. What power will you raise on E to get a 3? It has to be more than 1, yaar. Yes, it is somewhere close to 1.1. Okay. ln 2 value is 0.69 that you're already aware of, isn't it? Okay. So from there, you can make an estimation, you know, depending upon the question. Okay. So I hope this is helpful, Aditya, to solve your question. So please proceed from here on. Let's take more questions on this. Let me take a question based on the same. See, all depends on the option. All depends on the option. You have to look at the option and then take a call. Okay, so let's take a question. The question is, prove that integral of 5 minus x upon 9 minus x square will always lie between 1 and 1.2. Prove that integral of 5 minus x upon 9 minus x square, integral limits are from 0 to 2, this value will always lie between 1 and 1.2. a bit of global maxima, minima, or absolute extrema concept has to be brought in over here, which I'm sure all of you are familiar with. Done. Very good. Anybody else other than Shitish? Pranav also done. Very good. Guys, let me also tell you one very important thing here. Many of the schools have not even started integration because of the term one exam. And I have a feeling that it is going to be tested for your KVPY. So you have an upper hand with respect to your competitors for KVPY because you are very much trained in your integration skills. Okay. So it's very important that you capitalize on it and make a, you know, impact in the, on the, in the exam. Okay. So please make use of this advantage because many places, the school has not even started with integration because they are very much doing your semester one topics. Okay, so let's discuss this. So let me call this function as f of x as of now. So let me find out, first of all, if there is any local extrema for this. Let's put the derivative as zero. Okay, so let's differentiate it. So 9 minus x square times minus 1 minus 5 minus x times minus 2x upon 9 minus x square the whole square. Okay, put it to zero. So this gives you, I'm just working out on the numerator part because that will be zero. So this will be negative x square. You will get positive 10x. You will get minus 9. This should be zero. Okay, this is as good as saying x square minus 10x plus 9 equal to zero. This is factorizable as this. Okay. So there are two critical points, 1 and 9. 9 is of no use to us because our limit of integration is 0 to 2. Okay. So please do not waste your time going beyond the limits of integration. Okay. Now, when I am evaluating the global maxima or minima, what do? I check the value of the function at 0. I check the value of the function at any local extrema. And of course, I check the value of the function at 2 as well. Okay, at 0, this gives me 5 by 9, undoubtedly. At 1, it will give me half because it will become 4 by 8. At 2, it will become 3 by 5. Okay, out of the three, the least is half. So this is your small m. Okay, and out of these two, which is more? Of course, 9. Which is more, 5 by 9 is more or 3 by 5 is more? 3 by 5 is more, right? So this is your m. Okay. So in the light of this property, I can say the given integral will be lying between m times b minus a and capital M times b minus a. That means your I will lie between half into 2 and 3 by 5 into 2, which is actually 1 to 6 by 5. 6 by 5 is 1.2. Okay, so keep this also in your mind in case you are met with a question which requires you to use this. Okay, you don't always have to, you know, figure out a function between which, or you don't have to always figure out two functions between which this function is lying. Okay, maybe your global maxima minima also will do the trick for you. Next, property number 3. We are still in the inequality properties, don't worry. So property number 3 is a very obvious property. It says that if you integrate a function between a to b and take its absolute value, okay, this value will always be lesser than the integral of the absolute of the function from a to b. Okay. Now, this is very obvious. People will say, sir, it can be proved. Let's say there's a function which is, you know, taking turns like this. Okay. So this is your f of x function and you are integrating it from, let me just keep it away from the origin, else it'll become a very special case. Yeah. So let's say we are integrating it from a to b. Okay. So as you can see, there is a positive part of this particular integral and there's a negative part. Okay. So overall, this answer would be lesser than the area that you would get had you taken a mod of the complete function before integrating. So something like this. So had you integrated it between a to b, the mod of that given function, this is your mod of f of x, all these areas would have been positive. Okay, so this area would be more. Can somebody tell me when will the equality hold true? When does the equality hold true? Anybody? Okay. When the function is completely positive or completely negative. Okay. In the interval a to b. So if the function is completely positive, that means above the x-axis, the mod of that area or mod of that algebraic area would be equal to the area between the mod of the function. Okay. So when it is completely positive or completely negative, that means it is wholly on one side of the x-axis. Okay. Is it fine? Okay. I mean, there's nothing, you know, important related to this property. Let's not bother about, okay, not very important one, but just keep a note of this property as well in case you require it. Next property number four. Let me take it to the next slide. If you want, I can give you a small question based on this. Prove that integral of sine x by 1 plus x to the power 8 from 10 to 19. This integral will always be lesser than 10 to the power of minus 7. No, nothing like that. Shitesh, nothing like that. Could go through origin as well. Special case, basically I asked the question, when will this equality exist? This is what I was asking, right? Oh, I said that if it is from A to B, let me not make A as an origin, A as a, you know, 0 point. That's what I said. I mean, as per the diagram, I didn't want to make a very special diagram. That's what I said. Should we discuss it out? We have a lot of things to cover today. So can I say this integral from 10 to 19 sine x by 1 plus x to the power 8 dx, this will be lesser than, okay, integral of 10 of this function itself from 10 to 19, okay, as per the property that I just now discussed, okay, in light of this property. Now, let's talk about this guy's mod sine x by 1 plus x to the power 8. First, I would like to start with x to the power 8. Can I say x to the power 8? And I'm looking at the interval 10 to 19. Okay. Can I say this fellow will always be more than 10 to the power 8? Because the least value x can take is 10. Okay. So between 10 to 19, if I pick up any x, its value will be greater than or equal to 10 to the power 8. Everybody agrees with this. Correct. In other words, can I also say this? Okay. Everybody is happy with this inequality which I have written, or this set of inequalities which I have written. Now, let's reciprocate it. If you reciprocate it, the inequality is going to switch. Okay. So it's going to become this. Yes or no? Right. So basically what I want to say here is that sine x by 1 plus x to the power 8, that will definitely be lesser than 1 by 10 to the power 8. So now just compare these two fellows. Okay. And I'm multiplying sine x over here. That means I'm making it even more lesser. So multiplication of sine x to 1 by 1 plus x to the power 8 will make it even more lesser. So it will be a pure inequality over here. Correct. In other words, can I say this will also be lesser than this? Right? So in short, you have got a function which is basically lesser than this guy. So can I say this integral will be lesser than integral of 1 by 10 to the power 8 from 10 to 19? Right? Which happens to be 19 minus 10 into 1 by 10 to the power 8, right? And that comes out to be more or less 9 into 10 to the power minus 8. And this fellow has to be lesser than 10 into 10 to the power minus 8, which means it is lesser than 10 to the power 7, because this is actually 10 to the power minus 7. So that given integral will be lesser than 10 to the power minus 7, hence proved. So there are series of inequality which I used over here. First, I started with my property, which I discussed. Okay. And then I used my first property where I said that if one function is lesser than the other, okay, and both of course are, you know, are integrated between the same limits, then even their limits, even their integrals will follow the same property. And then I further made it as 10 to the power this. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns with respect to this solution? Can I move on to the next one? Please have a look at it. Please, make yourself convinced. Then only allow me to move further. All right. So no objection anybody has. Very good. I think property number 4 under inequality. If f square x and g square x are integrable functions in the interval a comma b, okay, then the product of f of x into g of x integral modulus from a to b. This will always be lesser than equal to integral of f square from a to b times integral of g square from a to b whole under root. This property is useful whenever your function involves some kind of square rooting or some kind of an irrational function which can go away by squaring the function, and there is an inequality being asked to you in the problem. Okay, not a very useful property. Not many questions have been asked on this property, but it's good to know it, because in case you require it, you can use it. So we'll prove this property first. The proof is slightly weird. What I'll do is, first of all, I'll take a function like this, okay, where lambda is some real number. Okay, so can I say, since it is a perfect square, it will always be positive? Okay, so we already know that such kind of an expression will always be greater than equal to zero, because you are squaring it, it's a perfect square. Okay. Now, if this function is completely above the x-axis, so can I say the area of this function between a to b, or integral of this function between a to b, that will also be positive. Okay, let's expand it. So if you expand it, you'll end up getting something like this: a to b lambda square g square x dx minus 2 lambda a to b f of x into g of x dx and plus a to b f square x dx. So this will be greater than or equal to zero. Okay, now let's do one thing. Let's pull out this lambda square out, because lambda is some real number. Now if you see this entire left side expression, it is actually a quadratic in lambda. And a quadratic in lambda is always greater than or equal to zero. So when can a quadratic, so please recall your basic concept here of a quadratic inequality. And A is positive. A is already positive, because this is going to be a positive quantity, because you know it's you're integrating a positive function between A to B. Okay. So if A is positive, can I say this inequality will hold true only when the discriminant here is less than zero? In fact, since it is greater than or equal to, it will be less than or equal to also, because it may touch the x-axis also. Correct? So in other words, b square minus 4ac. Now please note, who is acting like your small a, who is acting like, in fact, I should use my capital alphabets here, because small a and small b are already in use in the question. So I'll make it as capital AX square BX plus C. This is capital A is greater than zero, right? This is already true. So your discriminant should be less than zero. So what is the, who's playing the role of capital A over here? The capital role is A is being played by this term, integral from A to B G square x dx. Capital B role is being played by minus 2 a to b f of x into g of x dx. And your capital C role is being played by a to b. Oh, let me write it in white only. A to b f square x dx. Okay, so b square minus 4ac, that is your discriminant, should be less than or equal to zero. So b square is 4 a to b f of x into g of x dx the whole square. Okay, this should be less than or equal to 4ac. This is your c and this is your a. Okay. Drop the factor of 4 from both the sides. Right. So now please note, if you are taking an square root on both the sides, this will become mod. So this will be less than equal to under root of this. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Any questions, any concerns with respect to the proof? Okay. One small question we'll take on this property before we move on to the next concept. So one last question I would like to take up on the inequality properties. We have already spent 1 hour on this property. So question is, prove that integral from 0 to 1 of this integrand under root of 1 plus x. Okay. This value will always be less than equal to 15 by 8. This value will always be less than equal to 15 by 8. Okay. Now, as you can see, when I'm giving you these questions, an obvious question will arise in your mind that how would I know which of the properties is going to help me? Is it going to be your limiting of the function between two functions? Is it going to be your maxima minima property? Right? Is it going to be the the mod property? Is it going to be the property which I just now discussed? So you have to do some trial and error. It is not like straightforward mechanism that okay, this is the way I have to solve it. So that is all about you figuring it out through reverse engineering. What will work? What will not work? And of course, your options will be there to guide you. Your options will be there to guide you. Oh, sorry, this will be under root of. I'm sorry about that. Yes, yes, why not? All chapters, numerical type questions will be there. Why your definite integral cannot give an integer answer? Hint is treat your f of x as under root 1 plus x. Keep your g of x as under root 1 plus x cube and use the previous property. Just write it done if you're done. Shambhu is done. So just recall the property mod of integral of the product. So when you integrate the product of f and g from a to b, take the modulus, this quantity will always be less than or equal to, okay, product of the square of these function integral from a to b individually. Okay. So as per our given choice, our integral of under root 1 plus x times 1 plus x cube, okay, this will lie, so between 0 to 1, square of under root 1 plus x is 1 plus x. So please integrate it separately. You all know how to do it. Square of under root of 1 plus x cube is going to be this. Integrate it separately. I hope you all are comfortable. I hope you are comfortable integrating these. So this is going to be, I'm just going to do it separately just to not make it very cluttered over there. So it's x plus x square by 2 from 0 to 1. That will give you 3 by 2. Similarly, 1 plus x cubed dx, x plus x to the power 4 by 4 from 0 to 1 will give you a 5 by 4. Okay. So this will be less than 3 by 2 into 5 by 4 under root. So this will be less than equal to under root of 15 by 8. Hence proof. Easy. Now, we are now going to move towards a slightly challenging part of this topic, which is primarily for students who are for JEE Main and JEE Advanced exam. Okay. So, can we move on to the next concept for this? Any questions that you have here, please do let me know. Okay, so now we are going to move towards two famous improper integrals called the gamma function and the beta function. Gamma function and the beta function. Okay, these functions are basically gamma function and the beta function. These functions are basically related to an integral. Okay, and the integral is actually called an improper integral. What is improper integral? Many people ask me, what is the meaning of an improper integral? See, improper integral is where your limits are not proper. For example, something like integrating from 0 to infinity. Okay. So these are, or minus infinity to infinity. So if you realize that any one of your limits, okay, they are not a definite number. They are basically an infinity minus infinity kind of a, you know, limit. Then these integrals are called improper integrals. So they are two important types of, or two important cases of improper integrals. Okay. You will understand when once I define this function. Okay. So let us start with gamma function first. Okay. Why I'm discussing this concept here is because many a times, you can use these functions to solve certain complicated and time-consuming problems, which otherwise will become very difficult and tedious for you to solve. However, this is a subject matter of your undergraduate syllabus. It is not going to be taken in your 11th and 12th curriculum. It is basically taken in your first or second year, second semester of your engineering, you know, course studies. Okay. Yes, Raghav. So I'm just introducing this concept because in case you think your gamma function, beta function concepts is going to help you solve those questions, and I'm going to derive a very interesting result also from the same, which is called the Wallace formula. And in the previous years, people have found these functions to be useful in solving many problems. However, many of the things I will not be proving for you because it is not required, or it requires some higher level calculus concepts, which has not been taught to you, which has not been introduced to you in the past. Okay. So at some places I will say, okay, take down this result. It will be useful without actually proving it. Right. So let's get started with gamma function. First of all, I'll come to beta function a little later on. Gamma function. So gamma function is basically an integral which looks like this. 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power n minus 1 dx. Okay. Now, as you can see, there is a parameter n. That's why it is basically a function of n. And this n has to be greater than 0. Okay. So this entire integral, when you evaluate it, it's going to give you an answer in terms of n, isn't it? So that becomes, that integral itself becomes a function of n, and n should be a positive quantity over here. Okay. It should be greater than zero. Okay. Then this result is basically called as gamma n. By the way, we don't use this notation f. What do we use? Instead of this, we use a symbol which is opposite of factorial notation. I hope many of you have seen this notation for factorial. Don't get confused. This is factorial n. Okay. This is gamma n. This is to be read as gamma n. Gamma n. Okay. So don't get confused between these two notations. However, this notation is a very old notation of factorial. If you would pick up a very old book of algebra where they have discussed factorial, you would see that they have used this notation for factorial, L. This is not an L. You can say this is a bracket. You can call it as a half of your the ceiling functions that you have. Okay. Anyways, so don't make a mistake about this notation. Now, this expression, in fact, is asked many a times to evaluate. Okay. It's not that you cannot evaluate it, but if you know the result for it, it will make your life very simple, right? For example, if I ask you this question, find 0 to infinity e to the power x, sorry, e to the power minus x, x to the power 5. Okay. How will you find this out? How will you find this particular thing out? You will use product rule, correct? Yes or no? You can use your DI method there, right? Treating your x to the power 5 as your u and treating your x e to the power minus x as your v, correct? So let us try to solve this question by using our integration by parts and see how lengthy was it when I'm solving it by integration by parts. Okay. So first of all, I'll just write my DNI. I will be using my DI method. I hope everybody is aware of DI method, right? Especially in the case where one of the integral vanishes. So start differentiating it. Okay. Right. Start integrating it. Correct. Attach positive negative signs. Fine. And your integral without the limits. I'm not putting the limits as of now. Your integral, indefinite integral would be plus x to the power 5 minus this, which is minus e to the power minus x to the power 5. So basically, I'm multiplying this, multiplying this, multiplying this, multiplying this, multiplying this, multiplying this. Okay. So this will give me minus 5 x to the power 4 e to the power minus x. This will give me minus 20 x to the power 3 e to the power minus x. Then I'll have minus 60 x square e to the power minus x. Then I'll have minus 120 x e to the power minus x. And finally, I'll have minus 120 e to the power minus x. Okay. Now in each of them, you have to find the limit of integration from infinity or zero to infinity. Now for infinity, you have to take a limiting case. Okay. So let's say this term, I want to find out what is the value of this when x tends to infinity. Okay. So I'll have to take a limiting case. Can anybody tell me what will be this answer? What will be the answer of limit of x to the power 5 by e to the power x tending to infinity? Come on, fast. It should be, 1 second answer. Anybody? Right. Absolutely. Okay. See, exponential function is infinitely more than a polynomial function when x is very large. Remember, always remember. polynomial divided by exponential, and both of them have been, you know, let's say both of them are tending to infinity, exponential function will be much bigger. Both are infinities, I don't doubt that. But exponential functions are much more than the polynomial functions. So overall, this result will be a zero, right? So when you put the upper limit, everywhere you'll get a zero, right? Isn't it? This will also give you zero, this will also give you zero, this will also give you zero, this will also give you zero. Okay, and when you put a zero, you will realize that all of them will give you a zero other than the last term, which is going to give you minus 120. So the answer is actually 120 for this. Now, let me tell you, we spend around 3 to 4 minutes doing this problem. But how about if I told you the answer to this, the answer to this will actually be 5 factorial. Right? Won't it make your life a little easy? Now you must be wondering, sir, 5 factorial, how did you get that? Is it because it came out to be 120? You said 5 factorial, no. Okay, so there is a set of results which I'm going to give you. And if you use them, you're going to save a lot of your time while solving these kind of a questions and questions related to them as well. Okay, so let us try to discuss this. I basically wanted you to show a demonstration that if you are going to solve this question like a normal aspirant who has not been introduced to gamma function, you are going to take a lot of time to solve such kind of questions, thereby eating up your precious time of your exam. Okay. All right. So let's discuss it out. So how do I get this 5 factorial result is what I'm going to discuss with you all. So I'm first going to use a reduction formula over here. I'm going to prove something very interesting. I'm going to prove a reduction formula applicable to gamma function. Okay, and what is this formula? This formula is gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n. Okay, gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n. Okay, let us prove this first. Proof is not very difficult. What is gamma n plus 1? As per the definition of the gamma function, gamma n plus 1 will be 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n plus 1 minus 1, correct? Which in short is 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n dx, okay? Now what I will do, I will use my integration by parts on this, okay? In fact, I should ask you to prove it because you have already gone through the reduction formula or the recursive formula. So if I use integration by parts on this, this is going to give me x to the power n, e to the power minus x integral will be minus e to the power minus x. Okay, limits of integration is 0 to infinity. And then 0 to infinity derivative of x to the power n will be n x to the power n minus 1. Integral of e to the power minus x will be e to the power minus x, of course, with a minus sign over here. So minus minus will become a plus. By the way, this is something which I already told you will be a zero. I hope everybody is convinced with that. Just now I discussed, no, polynomial divided by exponential, upper limit will give you a zero if you put infinity. And lower limit is anyways a zero because x zero to the power any, you know, number greater than zero will give you a zero. So now this term here is plus n times 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n minus 1. Isn't this expression gamma n? Isn't this expression gamma n? So can I not say that gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n? Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay. Now, if you look at the previous question that I asked you to evaluate this integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus x into x to the power 5. Remember, Can I say this was actually gamma six? Isn't it? Because please treat this as n minus one. Okay. So I asked you for gamma six, isn't it? So can I use this recursive relation and say this is five gamma five? Can I use the same relation and say gamma five is four gamma four? Can I not say it is three gamma three? So I'm just using the same relation. So on this, I'm applying the recursive relation that I just now discussed. Okay. And then on gamma four, I'm applying same property, same recursive relation or same reduction formula. So if I continue doing it, I get 5 into 4, 3, then this will be 2 gamma 2. And this will become 1 gamma 1. Now let's discuss what is gamma one. Gamma one is something which we can evaluate easily. Gamma one will be integral of 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power 1 minus 1, which is as good as integrating e to the power minus x. Okay, what is the integration of e to the power minus x? Infinity will give you a 0, and putting a 0 will give you a 1. So this answer will be a 1. In short, it becomes 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1 into 1, which is actually 120. And that's nothing but 5 factorial as well. Okay, so this is the result which I got in the previous case, but of course, through a longer way by using our integration by parts. So it's not that I did not use integration by part here, but I found out a recursive relation which helped me to solve this question. So please note this down. This is very, very important. And just add to it that if n happens to be a natural number, okay, or in fact, you can say a whole number in this case. No, let it be a natural number because then this will become a, yeah. So if n happens to be a natural number, then gamma n plus 1 actually boils down to n factorial. Okay, so this result is also very, very important. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? You can say so, Shitij. Related to factorial, that's why it is having this symbol. So Shitij has a very careful observation, and he said, is it that the reason for this symbol to happen is because it is related to factorial? You can say so. Okay, let's take a question on this. Let's take a question on whatever we have done so far, and you will see how gamma function could be very helpful in solving those questions. No, it will not work if n is not great. This recursive relation will work if n is not, even not a natural number, but it has to be greater than zero. Why it will be greater than zero? Because if you see, Aditya, while proving this, I wrote this guy to be zero. This is only possible when n is greater than zero. Else it will not be possible. If n is a number which is negative, it will become an undefined expression even for zero. Okay, but yes, this recursive relation is true even if n is not a natural number. If n becomes a natural number, this gives you a special result that it becomes n factorial. Okay, I'll give you more information a little later on. After this question, I'll give you some more information about gamma function. Okay, question is evaluate the value of the integral ln 4 to the power 5 times 0 to infinity x to the power 4 by 4 to the power x dx. Evaluate ln 4 to the power 5, 0 to infinity, x to the power 4 by 4 to the power x. Let's see who gives me the result. See, you can always do it by integration by parts. You can treat x to the power 4 as your d. You can treat 4 to the power minus x as your v. Okay. And keep applying di, you know, and do it. And then evaluate your upper and the lower limits by using your limits concept. But I would like you to use your result of gamma function to solve this question. Gamma function just saves your time, saves your effort from, you know, going into a prolonged version of DI. Very good, Janardhan. Who is Janardhan? Hariharan only, no? Is it Hariharan? I'm wondering who is Janardhan. No issues, no issues. That also looks cool, Janardhan. Okay, so I think we are already familiar with this definition. Okay, now see. Let us look at this integral. Very good. I think most of you have got it. Correct. Correct, correct, correct. Answer is 24. Correct. Okay, now look at this integral, x to the power 4, 4 to the power minus x. Now all of you first recall some basic log properties. Okay. So please recall, 4 to the power x could be written as e to the power ln of 4 to the power x, which is nothing but e to the power x ln 4. So can I write instead of x 4 to the power x, e to the power x ln 4 whole to the power of minus 1? Correct. Yes or no? So this is e to the power minus x, x to the power 4. Now remember, e to the power minus ln 4 will also come into picture. Okay. I should have written that as well. E to the power minus x ln 4 x to the power 4 dx. Okay. Now in order to make it as a gamma function, I have a small substitution that I would like to do here. I would like to call x ln 4 as a t. Okay. So dx will be 1 by ln 4 dt. Correct? And x will be t by ln 4 also. So now e to the power minus x ln 4 is e to the power minus t. X to the power 4 is t to the power 4 by ln 4 to the power of 4 because x was raised to the power of 4. Correct? And dt, dx will become dt by ln 4. So, or more the less, I mean, the power is going to become 1 more over here and it's going to become a 5. Anybody has doubt in this transition and limit of integration is not going to change because as x is 0, t will also be 0 and x is very, very large, t is also going to be very, very large. Okay. Oh, no wonder they had given ln 4 to the power 5 outside. Oh, now I understood. So now the actual integral was ln 4 to the power 5, 0 to infinity, e to the power of, x to the power of 4 by 4 to the power x. So this will now become, correct me if I'm wrong, into 1 by ln 4 to the power 5, 0 to infinity, e to the power minus t, t to the power 4. Okay. This will get cancelled. Now this is clearly gamma 5. Okay. Don't worry about the variable name. It doesn't matter whether you call it as t or x, it's going to be gamma 5. And remember what did I say? If n is a natural number, gamma n plus 1 is n factorial. So here I can write it as gamma 4 plus 1 and gamma 4 plus 1 will be 4 factorial. Answer is 24. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now, related to gamma function, I have some more information that I want you to take down. Okay. Some of them we will not go into details of. Okay. Important points about gamma function. We already seen that gamma n plus 1 follows a recursive relation. Okay. And if n happens to be a natural number, gamma n plus 1 will lead to n factorial. Okay. So there is a special value that I would like to discuss with you. Let me call this as property one itself. Okay. Gamma half. Gamma half is a value which is going to be very useful, at least in many of the questions that we are going to see related to Wallis formula. I'll talk about Wallis formula later on in this discussion. But gamma half is given a special value. In fact, this value, I will derive it also. Gamma half is under root of pi. That is to say, 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power minus half dx, this value is given to be a root of pi. Now we'll prove it. We'll prove it in some time. Okay. Just make a note of this first. Now this proof is slightly overboard. It may, you know, go above your head also, but don't worry. I will try my best to make things clear to you. So in order to prove this, I will use, first of all, a small substitution. Let's call x as y squared. Okay, let's substitute x as y squared. Okay, so when you substitute x as y squared, of course, your dx becomes 2y dy. Okay, let's see what happens to the entire integral. So this integral becomes, that is gamma half becomes 0 to infinity. Please note when x is 0, y is also 0. X is infinity, y is also infinity. E to the power minus y square into This term is y to the power of minus 1, and there's already a 2y dy. Okay, so this y and y to the power minus 1 will get cancelled off. Okay, so this is going to give you, this is going to give you twice of 0 to infinity e to the power minus y square dy. Correct? Okay. Now, can I say there's nothing in the name? I can write this back to 2 times 0 to infinity e to the power minus x square dy. Sorry, x square dx. Both will be gamma half only. Okay. Let's multiply these two. Let me call this as 1. Let me call this as 2. So let's multiply 1 and 2. So when you multiply 1 and 2, you end up getting gamma half square as 4 times 0 to infinity e to the power minus x square dx into 0 to infinity e to the power minus y square dy. Okay. Now, when you're integrating, such case, you will learn it a little later on in your undergraduate that you can write it as a double integral like this. Okay. See, don't worry about the proof. It is not going to be asked anywhere. It is just for your extra information. Maybe in your first year of undergraduate, you'll study this and then you'll realize that, we were told all these things in our class 12 itself. Okay. Now, here is a concept of converting a differential area from Cartesian coordinates to polar coordinates. So please note this down. Dx dy in terms of polar coordinates is given as r dr d theta. Now many people ask me, sir, how do you get this result? So there are two ways to get this result. One is by the let's say this is your small patch of area on your Cartesian coordinate system. Let's say this is your dx, this is your dy. Okay, let us try to relate it to a polar coordinates. Okay, let me make it slightly tilted. Okay, let's keep it like that. Okay, so let's keep it approximately. Let's call this length as I'll make it slightly tilted so that it fits in the diagram. Okay, just slightly tilted. Okay, so let's call this as r. Let's call this length as dr. Okay, and let's say I call this angle to be a d theta angle. Let's say this angle was theta. Okay, so this dx dy, length can be approximated as the product of dr, that is this length, okay, into this length. Now this length is approximately r d theta. Okay, so that is how this relation actually comes. Little later on, you will learn that there is a concept of Jacobian that will be taught to you in your undergrad. From there, you can get these kind of relations pretty easily. So this is a relation which relates differential area in the Cartesian to the differential area in the polar. Okay. So here, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put my x as r cos theta and y as r sine theta. That means, in short, I'm going to write x square plus y square as an r square. Okay. So this entire integral, let me write it down here. So this entire integral, which is gamma half the square, which is this entire integral becomes 0 to, now I'll not put the limit of integration as of now. I'll just first convert everything in terms of r and theta. Okay. So what I did, I replaced my x square plus y square as an r square. Correct. And I replaced my dx dy as r dr d theta, as I already discussed with you. Okay. Now don't worry too much about getting into the details of this, because anyways, this will be a subject matter taught to you in your engineering course of mathematics. Okay. Now what happens to the integration? Now see, you're integrating things from 0 to infinity, both in x and y. Okay. So can I say r will go from 0 to infinity? And since y is going from 0 to infinity, theta will go from 0 to pi by 2. So remember, r will go from 0 to infinity and theta will go from 0 to pi by 2. That's how you will cover everything from 0 to infinity in x and 0 to infinity in y. So basically, you are covering everything in this zone, correct? So your r can go anywhere from 0 to infinity and theta value can go anywhere from 0 to pi by 2. So this limit of integration, you can change it from 0 to pi by 2 and 0 to infinity. 0 to pi by 2 is meant for your angle, which is just d theta. And 0 to infinity is meant for this guy. Okay, so this is going to be gamma half the square. Okay, we are almost nearing the end of our discussion. So this is plain and simple. This is going to be 4 into theta from 0 to pi by 2 will be pi by 2 only. This integral you can perform separately. Let me perform that integral separately. 0 to infinity e to the power minus r square r dr. You can take r square as a t. So 2r dr will be dt. So this is going to become 0 to infinity e to the power minus t. And this is going to be dt by 2. Correct? So this is half e to the power minus e to the power minus t, 0 to infinity. Infinity will give you a 0. 0 will give you a minus 1. So this will become a half. Okay. So now the 4 and the half will get cancelled off. So what did we get here? We got here gamma half the whole square is pi. So gamma half is going to be root pi, hence proved. Okay. Again, I am not worried about you understanding the proof. I'm worried about you keeping this result in your mind. This result itself is important. Ye result is going to help you in solving many questions which will be coming for your JEE exam. Okay. So keep that in mind. That's it. Nothing. Don't worry about getting into your conversion from differential area in Cartesian to differential area in your this thing. All these double integration, all that is going to be taken care later on. Is it fine? Why did we switch it? Because here we were at a dead end. We could not integrate over here. So in order to facilitate further integration from here, we had to switch from Cartesian to polar. How did we apply the limits? 0 to pi by 2, you are asking, and 0 to infinity. So there are two variables involved, Hariharan. One is r, which is going from 0 to infinity, because you have to cover everything in the first quadrant, isn't it? So in order to access all the points in the first quadrant, your r has to go from 0 to infinity. And your angle, the argument of the, any point has got r and theta, right? So that theta value will sweep all values from 0 to pi by 2. Understood? How did I write 0 to pi by 2 and 0 to infinity? Okay. Now again, don't worry too much about it. We have very less time and we have more things to cover. So just write this result and let's move on. Trust me, these things will not be tested in JEE. Because JEE people know that you are not trained. You will not be trained till this extent that you know all these, double integrals and all. Which last step? This step, blue one. Ayo. E to the power minus t. Anyways, this is gamma one only, no? 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power 1 minus 1. This is gamma one only, right? Gamma one will be 0 factorial. 0 factorial will be 1. So it is 1 into half. Aise bhi soch lo. I mean, so many ways to think of it. All right, so please note this down. Now we are going to the next important property. Again, I will not be proving them because the next property is, next property is, note down, gamma n, gamma 1 minus n is pi sine n pi. Pi by sine n pi. Or pi n, whatever you want to call it. Okay. Where n has to be here in this case, n has to be between 0 to 1. Right? Gamma for negative values is not defined. Even gamma 0 is infinity. So please also note that gamma zero is infinity. Okay, it's not defined. So we'll be restricting our n here from zero to one. This is a very interesting property of gamma function. And this is given a special name because Euler basically proved it. Okay, and this is called the Euler's reflection formula. I will not be proving it because it requires your understanding of a little bit of Maclaurin's series and Weierstrass inequality from where Bessel's formula was proved. But I don't want to get into all those things. Just keep this in your mind. Gamma n, gamma 1 minus n is pi by sine pi n. N has to be between 0 to 1. Okay. Just note it down. Last year I proved it, but it went above the head of many of the students. So it is not important. Let's not waste time doing this. So what is not important, we'll not invest our time there. In fact, I will take a small question and we'll try to do it a little later on, not as of now. Okay, we'll take it a little later on once we do beta function. Yeah, pi seems to be so irrational, but it is so well organized also at some times. Absolutely. Alpha, no. The next property is something which is very important for all of us. Okay, so in fact, I will talk about it through beta function. So we'll talk about beta function first, and then I'll come to this. Okay. So all of you have noted this down. So I'll be starting with now beta function concept. Beta function is basically a function which is bivariate, which means it has got two inputs. Unlike gamma function, which only has n as its parameter, beta function is a biparametric function where there are two parameters, m and n. Okay, m and n both are supposed to be positive. Okay, so beta function is defined in several ways. I will give you one of the ways. It is defined as integral from 0 to 1 x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1 dx. Okay, now many people say, sir, you said it is supposed to be an improper integral, but your limits are 0 to 1. How it is an improper integral? Don't worry. I'll give you more versions of beta functions. In fact, as a question to prove, okay, there you will realize that beta function is actually an improper integral. Of course, right now in the present definition, it looks like to be having limits which are very well defined, 0 and 1. But it can also be written as an improper integral. So we'll discuss it out through question. So note down, m and n here are positive values. Beta m comma n is defined as integral 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, into 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Okay. Now, question for all of you. Prove that. Number one, beta function can also be written like 0 to 1, x to the power n minus 1, 1 minus x to the power m minus 1. In short, your m and n positions are interchangeable. That means it doesn't matter whether you write m comma n or n comma n, the result is not going to change. But this is something which you have to prove right now. Okay, second thing you have to prove, that beta m comma n could also be written as an improper integral and of course from the previous property that you would have already proven, you could also write it like this. As you can see, this structure is now become an improper one. That is why we categorize beta function as an improper integral. So these two questions themselves are basically conversion of one integral to another. So that can, this can come as a question to you in your exam. So examiner knows that, okay, the student might not be aware of a beta function, but can he do this conversion because this requires his basic knowledge of definite integrals or basic properties of definite integrals. So this potentially can be a question to you where the question setter will say, okay, this is a integral. He will not say beta and all. Don't worry. They are not going to use technical terms, which you might not have heard of. They'll say, okay, this is an integral. This integral is which of the following? And he will give you options in terms of these integrals themselves. So this becomes a conversion of one integral to another integral type of question. So let's prove it. The first one is very easy to prove. I am sure you would have already proved it. How do you prove the first one? A1. King's property. Yes. Done first one. You may get a comprehension based question also, right? Yes, yes. Why not? Why not? But of course, comprehension, even if they ask it, they will not go to the concept of testing your idea of double integral, whether you can actually do double integral or not. Double integral, triple integral related concepts will not be tested. But yes, they may give you a concept where they put it as a comprehension, a new concept as a comprehension. So first one, in the interest of time, sorry, I'll be intervening over here and doing it quickly. So our initial definition of beta function was 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1 dx. So now use KP, use your King's property. So from your King's property, you can say it is 0 to 1, 1 minus x. Remember King's property, 0 to a f of x dx can be written as 0 to a f of a minus x dx. So this will become 1 minus 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Okay. So on slightly simplifying it, you'll end up getting 0 to 1. Now this is just an x. Okay. And this is actually, by the definition, it is beta n comma m. Okay. So please note that in beta function, it doesn't matter if you interchange m and n positions. It's not going to affect your result. Okay. Now the second one, the B part is important because that can be asked as a question. In fact, I will do it in the next slide, but first of all, you do it and let me know by a done that you're done with it. Okay, should we take it up? Okay, so let's take the B property on the next screen. So we need to prove that beta m comma n this could be either written as 0 to infinity x to the power m minus 1, 1 plus x to the power m plus n, or it could be written like any one of the two you prove, it's it's more or less the same because m and n positions can be interchanged. Okay. So let's do a small substitution in this. So we need to prove this. So in this, we'll do a small substitution. So all of you, please pay attention. Here I'm going to put my x as 1 by 1 plus y. Okay. Now, why did I choose this substitution? So I choose this substitution for two reasons. You will see here that when x becomes zero, okay, what happens to y? When x becomes zero, y will become infinity. Correct? Y will go to infinity. Okay. And when x becomes one, what will happen to y? So put your x as one and see what will happen. So one plus y becomes one. So y becomes zero. Correct? So the limits of integration are at least taken care of. And not only that, you'd also realize that 1 plus x kind of an expression which we were desiring to get, that also is addressed. Let us see how. So when I put these substitutions, your lower limit will be infinity, upper limit will be 0, and this will be 1 by 1 plus y to the power of m minus 1, 1 minus 1 by 1 plus y to the power n minus 1, dx will become minus 1 by 1 plus y the whole square dy. Can I say this will become your beta m comma n? Correct me if I'm wrong. Any questions, any concerns to highlight? Okay. Now, first of all, I would address this negative sign over here. I don't want to see any negativity. So I'll interchange my upper and lower limit. Okay. So here, if you see this part, this is actually y by 1 plus y, right? So you'll end up getting y to the power n minus 1. And down here, you will get 1 plus y to the power m minus 1 from the first guy. From the second guy, you'll get 1 minus y to the power n minus 1. And from the last guy, you'll get 1 plus y the whole square. Correct. In short, it becomes 0 to infinity y to the power n minus 1 by 1 plus y to the power m plus n. I hope that's very obvious, because m minus 1 plus n minus 1 plus 2 is m plus n. Okay. Now there's nothing in the name. Naam mein kya rakha hai? Sab kuch kaam mein rakha hai. Isn't it? Everything is in your skills, not in the name. Isn't it? So now we know that. We also know that there is nothing in the changing of the name of m and n. So basically, you can also write it as 0 to infinity x to the power m minus 1 by 1 plus x to the power m plus n. Okay, hence proved. So there are four notations for beta functions. So what is it? The first notation was 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Then in that you change your m and n position. That is second notation. Third notation is 0 to infinity x to the power n minus 1 by 1 plus x to the power m plus n. There also you change m and n position. So fourth notation is obtained from this. Altogether, four notation for beta function. Two of them are in improper version. Two of them are in proper version. Now, the most important connection, the most important property is the connection between beta function and gamma function. So many people say, sir, beta function, gamma function, are they related? Yes, they are related. They're very much related. And that relation itself is a very important relation for us. But I will not prove that relation because it requires, again, double integration and all, which is waste of time as of now for you. Just know the relation because that will be useful. So note down this. Any question, any concerns? Okay, so one of the most important is the property is the relation between beta function and gamma function. Beta function can actually be written in terms of gamma function. How? This is the relation. Beta m comma n is, note down, gamma m by gamma m plus n. And here also you can see that symmetricity between m and n is maintained. So even if you switch your m and n position, this value is not going to change. Okay. Proof not required for this. Proof basically goes by a double integration. If you want, I can send you the proof on the group. Okay. So if you want, I can send you some proofs of this on the group. Okay. So please note this down. Okay. Another thing that I forgot to tell you, in fact, there's another notation of beta function. Okay. And that is not a difficult notation, because anybody can figure it out by the use of trigonometric substitution. So we already learned that this was our expression for beta function, beta m comma m. Here put x as sine square theta. Okay. So dx will become 2 sine theta cos theta d theta. So make the substitution over here. So your beta m comma n will become 0 to, now when x is 1, this is going to be pi by 2. Okay. This is going to become sine to the power 2m minus 2 theta. This is going to become 1 minus sine square to the power n minus 1, which is cos square to the power n minus 1. Okay. And dx will become 2 sine theta cos theta d theta. Right. So here is another expression for beta function. Beta function can be written as 0 to pi by 2 twice of sine to the power 2n minus 1 theta cos 2n minus 1 theta. And remember, m and n positions can be swapped. That's a property which we all know. So this is another fifth representation for beta function. Okay. Now we will play with this expression a little bit. First note this down. So please note this down. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to write this beta function as gamma function, gamma m, gamma n by gamma m plus n. Okay. This is twice of 0 to pi by 2 sine 2 to the power m minus 1 theta cos 2 to the power n minus 1 theta. And I'm going to do a small change here. I don't like to see the shape of this power. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to call 2m minus 1 as m dash. Okay, I don't like the way it's written as an ugly power. I'm just writing it as a simpler power. Okay, let's say I call it as m dash and I call that as n dash. Okay, so when I make these substitutions over here, it'll become twice 0 to pi by 2 sine m dash theta cos n dash theta d theta. This is going to become, now please note down that your m is going to be m dash plus 1 by 2. And your n is going to be n dash plus 1 by 2. So this will become gamma m dash plus 1 by 2, gamma n dash plus 1 by 2, whole divided by gamma m dash n dash plus 2 by 2. In fact, I will do one more step over here. I will send this 2 down over here. Okay. Right. So now I got a useful result. Okay. So this is a useful result, which says if you want to integrate sine to the power m theta, again, there's nothing in the name. So I'm putting back things in terms of m and n. You can write it as gamma m plus 1 by 2, gamma n plus 1 by 2, by 2 gamma m plus n plus 2 by 2. Okay, so please note this result down. Whether you know the derivation or not, that is immaterial. You should know this result down. And if m and n happens to be whole numbers, then this formula is called the Wallis formula. Wallis formula. Okay. So we'll see some application of this formula in one of our questions. Now, this is one way to solve the question. I'm not denying it that if you don't know this approach, you will not be able to solve the question. No, don't get me wrong. I never mean to say that if you don't know this, you will not be able to solve this. But Wallace formula is just a mechanism by which we make our life simple while solving questions related to this or like this. Okay. So let's take a few questions. Do you want me to summarize everything? I can do that. That one page is good enough for you to keep in mind. So let me summarize everything. People who want to note it down, note it down. Then in the next page, I will summarize everything. Don't worry about it. Okay. So let's summarize. Summary of gamma and beta functions. Let's write it like this. Okay. So whatever I'm going to write in this summary, please remember only those stuff, your life will be easy. Okay. First of all, the definition of gamma function itself. Gamma n is defined as 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n minus 1 dx. Second thing, gamma function satisfies a recursive relation. Gamma n plus 1 can be written as n gamma n. And if n happens to be natural number, gamma n plus 1 becomes n factorial. Okay. Some special things value you should remember. Gamma 0 is infinity. Okay, I already know gamma 1 is going to be 1. Gamma 2 is also going to be 1 because of this property which I just now wrote. Okay, gamma 3 is going to be 2 factorial. Gamma 4 is going to be 3 factorial and so on. You already know this. And a special value, gamma half under root pi. Okay. And Euler's reflection formula is something that you should note down. Euler reflection formula says gamma n, gamma 1 minus n, where n is somewhere between 0 to 1 is given as pi by sine n pi. Okay, this is your Euler's reflection formula. Okay, related to beta function has the following definitions: 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Remember, m and n here are positive quantities. It could also be written as x to the power n minus 1, 1 minus x to the power m minus 1 dx. That is to say, beta m comma n and beta n comma m are same. Their positions of m and n can be interchanged. Apart from it, I gave you some improper integral notation for beta function, which is this. And since m beta m comma n is same as beta n comma m, this is also true. And of course, towards the end, I gave you a trigonometric relation, which is 0 to pi by 2 sine to the power 2m minus 1 theta into cos 2n minus 1 theta d theta. Okay, 5 relation for beta function. And I also gave you the connection between beta and gamma. Beta m comma n could be written as gamma m gamma n by gamma m plus n. And in light of these two properties, we ended up getting the famous Wallace formula, which says integral 0 to pi by 2. Why am I writing it higher level? Let's write here 0 to pi by 2 sine to the power mx cos to the power nx can be written as gamma m plus 1 by 2 gamma n plus 1 by 2 by twice of, just add these two, it will become m plus n plus 2 by 2. Okay, so if m and n happens to be natural numbers, okay, then it basically, in fact, whole numbers, not necessarily natural numbers, whole numbers, it becomes a case of Wallace formula. okay, summary of whatever we have learned. Main thing is questions. Okay, so first I will take some examples of Wallis formula. Sorry, if you have not noted it down, sorry, I just changed the slide without asking you. Let's take few questions and then we'll go for a break. Okay. After the break, we'll do a definite integral as limit of a sum and limit of a sum as definite integral. Okay. That is going to take not more than an hour or so. Can I go to the next slide? Okay. So let's take this question. Question is, integrate 0 to 1 x to the power 6 under root of 1 minus x square. Integrate 0 to 1 x to the power 6 under root 1 minus x square. Anybody? So this is what I say, knowing the formula is not important. Knowing the application of those formulas is important. See, how will you, you know, approach this problem normally? You will say, okay, let me substitute x as sine theta, right? This is the normal substitution that everybody will think of, isn't it? So this entire problem will become 0 to pi by 2 sine to the power of 6 theta. This will become cos theta, and sine theta derivative, that is also cos theta d theta. So if I'm not mistaken, it will become cos square theta d theta. Correct? Now, if you recall, this structure is very much same as what we had given for our beta function. So this can be written as, please note this down. Okay, this can be written as gamma m plus 1 by 2 gamma n plus 1 by 2 by 2 gamma m plus n plus 2 by 2. Correct. So in light of this, this will be gamma 7 by 2. Correct me if I'm wrong. Gamma 3 by 2 and 2 gamma 5. Isn't it? Now, gamma 5, most of you will say, sir, I know gamma 5. Gamma 5 is 4 factorial. 24. But what about gamma 7 by 2? Aapne kabhi bataya nahi. You never told me gamma 7 by 2. Okay, yeah, I don't have to tell you everything here. See, use your recursive relation. Gamma 7 by 2 can be written as 5 by 2 gamma 5 by 2. Correct? Remember, gamma n plus 1 can be written as n gamma n. And this gamma 5 by 2 can be written as 3 by 2 gamma 3 by 2. And this gamma 3 by 2 can be written as half gamma half. Correct? And what is gamma half? Gamma half is root pi. So why do we need to know the value of gamma 7 by 2 separately? Isn't it? Similarly, gamma 3 by 2, as I already told you, is half gamma half. So it will become half under root pi. So overall, let us simplify the result. So I think you'll have 15, not 15. I think this will go off by a factor of 8 at least. So 5 pi by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. What is 2 to the power 8? 2 to the power 8 is 256. This is your answer. Now just imagine what would have been the, you know, your state had you not known this formula, and you would have tried to solve this integral by your, let's say, your complex number substitution or, you know, your trigonometric identities. Will it be as simple and as straightforward as this? No, it would have taken you at least full 5 minutes to solve the question. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, now one straightforward question I will give you. Those who want to copy this can copy this. Those who want to attempt the next question, please do so. Find sine to the power 5 theta into cos to the power of, let's say, 4 theta. Now, this can easily be done by substitution. I'm not denying it. Okay, but let's try to use our Wallis formula to solve it, because here our powers are all natural numbers or whole numbers, so as to say. Okay, substitution will work. I'm not denying it. You can substitute cos theta as a t and solve the question. No problem in that. Okay, but let's use our Wallis formula also, since we have learned it new. So what will be the expression? Tell me. Gamma 5 plus 1 by 2, gamma 4 plus 1 by 2, by 2 times gamma, add this, add a 2, so 11 by 2. Okay, so let's see how fast or how slow is it. This is going to be gamma 3, gamma 3 is 2. This is gamma 5 by 2, gamma 5 by 2 is 3 by 2 into half root pi. Okay. And this is gamma 11 by 2. Gamma 11 by 2 will be 9 by 2, 7 by 2, 5 by 2, 3 by 2 into half gamma half, which is half root pi. So out of this, you can just cancel off 2, this whole thing, 2 and this whole thing. Your answer will be plain and simple. 8 upon, how much is this? 63 into 5. 63 into 5 is 195. Done. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Oh, sorry, 63 into 5 is 350. Good enough. Understood the use of a Wallis formula, which comes from your beta gamma function relation. Okay, one last question I'll give you, and then we'll just go for a break. One small question I would like you to solve. Can I go to the next slide? Okay, solve this question. Integrate 0 to infinity dx by 1 plus x to the power 4. Nobody. Okay. Let's put x to the power 4 as a y. Okay. So 4x cube dx. Okay. Let's do a simpler activity here. Let's write x as y to the power 1 by 4. Okay. So dx will become 1 by 4 y to the power minus 3 by 4 dy. Let's make this substitution. Please note the limit of integration is not going to change because of this substitution of x in terms of y. So dx will become 1 fourth y to the power minus 3 by 4 dy, and this term will become 1 plus y. Okay. Now try to recall something very familiar to us. Beta m comma n can be written as 0 to infinity x to the power of m minus 1. Okay, 1 plus x to the power m plus n. Correct. If you compare this, your m will become 1 by 4. Correct. And n will become 3 by 4. Isn't it? If you compare this expression to this expression, your m value is 1 by 4 and your n value is going to be 3 by 4 because m plus n is going to be actually a 1. Right? In short, this expression that you're evaluating is 1 fourth of beta 1 fourth comma 3 fourth. Correct? Let's write it down in terms of gamma function. So it's gamma 1 fourth, gamma 3 fourth, gamma m plus n is actually 1. So that leaves you with 1 fourth, gamma 1 fourth, gamma 3 fourth. But you'll say, sir, I don't know gamma 1 fourth and gamma 3 fourth. You only told me about natural numbers and you only told me about, you know, fractions, which are like multiples of half. Okay, now here, nothing to worry. If you look at it very carefully, it is like gamma n, gamma 1 minus n. Correct? N is a number here which is between 0 to 1. That's 1 by 4 actually. Which formula will help you here? Which formula will help you here now? Write down in the chat box. Euler's reflection formula. Correct? So that will give you pi by sine pi n. Correct? So what's the answer? Pi by 4. What is sine pi by 4? Sine pi by 4 is 1 by root 2. So the answer to this question is pi by 2 root 2. So I wanted to take this question just to show you how Euler's reflection formula can also be required to solve these kind of problems. Okay. Anyways, we'll take a break as of now. It's already going to be 11:30. Right now it's 11:23 a.m. Let's meet exactly at 11:35 a.m. Okay. We'll have to complete two more interesting concepts related to definite integral. Definite integral as limit of a sum and limit of a sum as definite integral. Okay. Enjoy your break. See you in 15 minutes time. So in this part, we are going to discuss how to write definite integral as limit of a sum. Okay. So we are going to look into two aspects. Definite integrals as limit of a sum. Don't worry, this is the basic ab initio method of finding a definite integral. Just like for derivatives, there used to be first principles. In the same way for definite integrals, if you want to evaluate it, you can evaluate it by using the concept of limits. Okay. So how do you express definite integral as a limit of a sum and vice versa? Okay, so we are going to study the two, you can say, directional conversion. One is definite integrals as a limit of a sum and limit of a sum as a definite integral. Okay, now this concept is basically related to your geometrical interpretation of a definite integral. So when you are integrating a function, let's say f of x from a to b, okay, what are we finding? We are trying to find out the algebraic area between the function and the x-axis, isn't it? So first of all, I'm going to, break this entire function into small rectangular strips. Okay, I'll not be drawing many. and just do a dot dot dot. Okay, so I'm just breaking this entire area into thin rectangular strips, each of thickness h. Okay, so this thickness is h, and there are n such strips. So this is your first strip. So this is a plus h. Okay, so I have broken down into n strips. Okay, da 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 da. Please note that this is going to be a plus n minus 1 h. Okay, that means a plus n h is actually equal to b. Right, so what I have done, I have broken down this entire area into n strips of width h. Okay, right, now we all know that if n becomes infinitely large, okay, if n becomes infinitely large, that means your h is almost tending to zero, then this integral or this sum of the area will basically give me the integral of the function from a to b, right? Now here a point to be noted is n is tending to infinity and h is tending to zero, but nh is still a finite quantity, which is b minus a, which comes from this. Okay, so please understand, zero into infinity doesn't mean zero, right? It could give you a finite quantity, and that quantity in this case is b minus a, right? So what are we doing here? We are basically trying to evaluate an integral by adding the area of all these small strips. Let me start with this strip first. What is the area of this strip? You'll say, sir, it will be h into f of a, isn't it? H being the width. So this is your h, and this height is going to be f of a. Correct? Similarly, what will be the area of this strip? You'll say h into f of a plus h. Similarly, what will be the area of this strip? So we'll say h into f of a plus 2h. Okay. And this goes on and on till I reach the last strip over here. Okay. And the area of this strip would be h into f of a plus n minus 1h. Correct. If you take a limiting case of h tending to 0 or n tending to infinity, then this particular limit should give you your desired integral, right? So this formula, please note it down. So this is a formula by which we can find out integral of a function from a to b by converting it as a limit question. Okay, now don't worry, I will show you some examples by which you can evaluate it. However, I have been told that in school, they have not taught this part, and it is more important from school point of view. So I will not be spending too much time. Yes, it's the basic. That's why I call it as an ab initio method or the first principle method of evaluating a integral. So in the school, they have not taught this, right? Have they? No, so I'll not spend too much time, because of course in JE you will not be asked to convert it to a limit of a sum and evaluate it. But this is for your overall knowledge. My purpose is to, you know, give you a complete knowledge. Whether it is asked or not, that's a different thing. So before you basically apply this formula, there are some prerequisites which you already know, but I'll just like to recall it for you. Prerequisite is you would require to know your following summations and limits. I think you are already aware of it from your class 11th days. Summation of all natural numbers from 1 to n is this. Summation of squares of natural numbers from 1 to n is n, n plus 1 to n plus 1 by 6. Okay. Summation of cube of natural numbers from 1 to n is n into n plus 1 by 2 the whole square. Apart from it, you should also be remembering your sine series. I don't know how many of you still remember it. Sine alpha plus beta, sine alpha plus 2 beta, till sine alpha plus n minus 1 beta. Okay, so this result is given by, who remembers this result? sin n beta by 2 by sin beta by 2 into sin of alpha plus n minus 1 beta by 2. Okay. Similar result for cos as well. So I'll write it down here. This is what we used to call it as cos series, sine series, cos series. This is given by sine n beta by 2. I'll write it slightly small because I'm just at the corner of the page. Okay, so the same formula is just that now you have a cos over here. So this formula and this formula, the way to remember it is this part will be same for both of them. Okay. And this part will also be same for both of them. It's just that instead of a sine over here, a cos will come. And of course, apart from it, some limits that you have already learned, sine x by x extending to 0 is a 1. Or you can say ln of, e to the power x minus 1 by x is, 1, etc. Okay. So limits, bit are limits and your basic special series and your trigonometric series. These are the some prerequisites you require. Okay. We'll take one or two questions, not more than that, because the other part is more important. Converting limit of a sum to a definite integral. That is more important. So anything that you would like to note down from here, prerequisites you already know, maybe you can note this down properly so that there's no mistake in copying this. Don't worry, n is tending to infinity, h is tending to 0, but your nh will be equal to, normally n and h looks the same, so I like it like this. Yeah, nh will be equal to b minus a. Okay, so all the three will be useful to solve a question. Why there is an h at the end? Which end you're talking about? Here. This h. Okay, let's take a question. Very simple question. Let's say I ask you, what is the integration of e to the power x from 1 to 3? Now, I know you know the answer, okay? But I have to solve this as a limit of a sum. So how do I solve it? So what am I going to do? First of all, understand what is your f of x? What's your a? What's your b? Okay? What's your nh? Nh is b minus a, which is 2. Okay? Now start using this formula, limit h tending to 0 or n tending to infinity or nh equal to b minus a. You can write all the things below this limit if you want. H into f of a plus h till f of a plus n minus 1h. Okay. F of a will be e to the power 1. F of a plus h is e to the power 1 plus h. Then 1 plus 2h. And so on till 1 plus n minus 1h. Fine. Limit h tending to 0, n tending to infinity. So these all are there at your disposal. I mean, depending upon the situation, we are going to use it. Now, mostly I've seen we require this guy more and this guy more. Okay, this is not that needed. Okay. Anyways, so here, if you see, it's actually a geometric progression with first term as e, common ratio as e to the power h, right? So total number of terms is n. Okay. But n is tending to b minus a. B minus a here is a 2. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. If you see this term, it is going to be e to the power nh minus 1 by e to the power h minus 1. Okay. Now, wherever an NH is formed, you can easily replace that with a 2. So as you can see here, there is an NH getting formed. So you can replace that with a 2. Okay. So it becomes H E cube minus E by E to the power H minus 1, limit H tending to 0. Now, there is no N required because N is already gone. Okay. So only H tending to 0 is helpful. Now, what is this limit? E to the power h minus 1 by h, h tending to 0 or reciprocal of that. That is anyways going to be a 1. So this entire answer becomes eq minus e, which you already know, And this is how you basically evaluate your definite integrals by using first principles. Ideally, I should have taught this in the beginning of the chapter, but I thought once I'm doing the limit of a sum as definite integral, I will introduce this concept to you. Is it fine? Is the process clear to everybody? Okay. One more question I will ask you to do it, and then we'll move on to the more important version, which is converting limit as a definite integral. That is more important for us. Yes, NH term will always appear somewhere. Wherever it appears, you have to immediately plug it up with B minus A. Let's take another one. Integrate cos x from A to B by first principles or by ab initio method. Last problem of this type, just to give you an idea so that you are, you know, aware of the process, how to write definite integral as a limit of a sum. Please note that complicated problems cannot be solved by this method. This is just, as a beginner, you should know that this is the way to solve it by converting it as a limit of a sum. Okay, so here NH is B minus A for sure. Of course, H is tending to 0 and is tending to infinity. So as a limit of a sum, it is H cos A, cos A plus H cos A plus 2H Fine. Now, in order to take care of this part, we have already discussed our cosine series. So I can write it as sine. Now, remember, alpha is A and our beta is H. So sine N beta by 2 is sine NH by 2. Okay. Into cos alpha plus N minus 1. Beta by 2. Okay. Now remember, H is tending to, limit H is tending to 0. Okay. N is tending to infinity and NH is tending to B minus A. Now, wherever there is a B minus NH coming up, please write it as a B minus A. Now I can see at these spots, I can see B minus A. So this is B minus A by 2. Okay, single edge, let it be as if as of now here itself. Okay, we'll take care of it a little later on. This is NH minus H by 2. H is anyways a 0 and this is B minus A. So overall, this will become, let me write it in a slightly more refined version. This is going to be A plus B minus A by 2, which is B plus A by 2. Okay. Now, why did I choose to write it like this? Because remember, my H is still there in the expression. So sine H by 2 divided by H by 2 or reciprocal of that is going to be 1. So that leaves you with the answer of 2 sine B minus A by 2 into cos B plus A by 2. Okay. Now, this is nothing but, whose formula is this? What is 2 cos A plus B? What is 2 cos B plus A by 2 into sine B minus A by 2? What is this? Whose transformation formula is this? Sine B minus sine A. Okay. So just to give you a demonstration of how to write definite integral as a limit of a sum. Now moving on to the last part, limit of a sum as a definite integral. Now there are certain questions of limits. If you would recall, I would have told you this in class 11th as well. There are certain question of limits, especially of the nature tending to infinity into zero or tending to zero into infinity types. Okay. So these indeterminate forms, they might not get solved by using our, you can say, summation formula. Or many times they are not even solved easily by your sandwich theorem also. So for those type of questions, there is an approach by which if there is a possibility, we can convert the limit of a sum as a definite integral. Okay. So what we learned was that in the previous discussion that if you have a integral like this to evaluate, you can write it as H summation f of a plus n minus 1 h. Okay. And your term, or you can write it like this, r minus 1 h. Okay. R is going from 1 to n. And the limit of h is 0 and limit of n is infinity, right? So this is what we had learned in our previous discussion, isn't it? Okay. Now I'm going to use a opposite, you know, discussion for this, and we'll try to convert this as a integral. Now, in order to convert this to this, I will tell you an algorithm. Okay, let's discuss an algorithm to do it, because by the use of that algorithm, you are going to solve this question. Or you're going to convert this limit as a definite integral very, very easily. By the way, some of you would already be knowing this expression is called the Riemann sum. Okay. So this expression is called the Riemann sum. Riemann sum. Okay. This expression. Okay. So how to write this Riemann sum type of expression as a definite integral? So what is the algorithm involved? So let me explain this through a simple example. I'll pull out a question and I will explain you how it works. Okay, maybe I'll take up a problem from my side because I'm not collected a problem of this nature. See, let us say I want to evaluate this integral. Sorry, this limit. Let's say limit n tending to infinity Very simple expression I will take up. Just take one by okay. This goes all the way till right. Now here, what is the approach? Let us try to understand the approach. Step number one, write down the rth term of this particular series that you're trying to sum up. So it's very simple. You have already done your series sequence and progressions chapter. So all of you are well versed in writing down the rth term here, which in this case is going to be r by n square plus r square. Okay. Second step is try to write tr as 1 by n times a function of r by n. That is, in this example, can I do this? Can I write it like 1 by n? Now this will become rn. Rn, I will do a small activity over here. Just give me a minute. Divide by n square both sides. Okay. So when you do that, it gives you 1 by n, r by n, 1 plus r by n the whole square. So this is what I'm trying to call as your function of r by n. Right? Now, why are we doing it? Let's try to understand it. See, we have already seen that n is a very large number. So 1 by n is a quantity which will be very small. So 1 by n starts playing the role of your dx. Okay. And second thing that you see here is that your x or your r by n, your r by n is going to play the role of your x. Okay. So why do we do this is because your r is changing, isn't it? Just like a variable changes, your r keeps on changing. Correct? And when your r changes from r by n to r plus 1 by n, this difference, let me write it in the other way around. This difference should actually become that dx term. This difference should actually become your dx term. That means 1 by n is your dx term. That is what we have. Okay. So as a result, this entire series where you are trying to sum up this from r equal to 1 till n and the limit of n is tending to infinity. So we convert this entire expression as, now see here, 1 by n will become dx. This term will become x by 1 plus x square. And your summation process will take the form of an integration. Okay. And what about limit of integration? Limit of integration is very simple. Since your x is r by n, when r is 1, x will approximately be 0 because 1 by a very large quantity will be 0. And when your r becomes n, then your x will become n by n, which is a 1. So your limit of integration will become 0 to 1. So as a result, this entire limit question got converted to what? It got converted to a integration question. Okay. And this is very easy to integrate. So you can multiply and divide with a half. Take 1 plus x square as a t. So it'll become ln mod 1 plus x square. 0 to 1. So when you put a 1, you get ln 2. When you put a 0, you get a ln 1, which is 0. So this becomes your answer. Is the process clear to you? Especially this step where you are writing down rth term as 1 by n times a function of r by n. This is where many people get stuck and do mistake. It should be a function of r by n. That means you should be able to write it in such a way that when you substitute r by n as an x, there is no stray n term. There is no stray r term. Stray means something which has not been attended to. Okay. So it should come out perfectly as a function of r by n. Clear? Is the approach clear to you? Then substitute 1 by n as an x. Sorry, 1 by n as a dx. Okay. So these two are the important substitution. Okay, so substitute 1 by n as your dx, substitute r by n as your x. Depending upon from where to where you are doing the summation, your limits of integration will accordingly change. Evaluate that definite integral, that would be the answer of that limit. See, from where to where you are integrating, where is your r going from? 1 to n, correct? And x is what? R by n. N being a very large number. So when r is 1, that is your first value of r, that would be your initial lower limit of your x. That is 1 by n. And n being a very large number, it can be taken as a 0. And your highest value of r that you are going to is your n. So n by n, that is your x is n by n, that will become a 1. So limit of integration will become 0 to 1. Now, let's say your integration was from 1 to 3n. I mean, r was going to from 1 to 3n. Then your upper limit will become 3, lower limit will remain a 0. Got it? Okay. Now, many people can get confused if the limit is going up, if the r value is going from 1 to n minus 1. If it is going to 1 to n minus 1, lower limit will be 0. Upper limit will still be 1 because n minus 1 by n, n is a very large number. Limits is a 1 only, right? So please do not get confused even if the summation is happening only till n minus 1. Okay. Let's take a few questions to get a hands-on on this type of problem. Yes, even if you go till n minus 1, it'll give you the same answer, right? Let's take a problem. The entire thing is multiplied to n. Yes. And for God's sake, don't start writing these answers as zero. Many people will say, sir, if I evaluate each of the limits separately, I'll get a 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. But remember, my dear, these are all tending to zero terms and they are infinitely many in number. So the answer will not be zero. It will be an indeterminate form. Okay. The algebra of limit is not going to work on this. So each quantity, each expression, even if you multiply with an n, that will all be zero, tending to zero, tending to zero quantity. But they are infinitely many in number. So the result here would be, the expression here would be an indeterminate form. Okay, it is not going to be zero. Please follow the algorithm which I discussed with you just now. Done. Very good, Shitish. That's correct. Correct, Aditya. Okay. See here, very simple process. Write down your arith term first. Arith term, if I am not mistaken, please don't make a mistake writing down the arith term. If you make a mistake in writing down the arith term, everything will go for a toss. This is the arith term. Correct? Now remember, the last term is 6n square, right? 1 by 6n square. That will come when your r becomes n. So here you're going till n. Okay, that's how it becomes n plus n to n. And n plus 2n is 3n. 2n plus 3n becomes 6n square. Okay. So this tells you that you are summing from r equal to 1 to r equal to n, right? So this is step number one. Step number two, as I told you, pull out a 1 by n common because I need that 1 by n as my dx, okay? So this will become n square. So this will become something like this. Now, this expression I have here, I have to write it as a function of R by N. Okay. So divide by N square, first of all, it will become 1 plus R by N, 1 plus 2 R by N. Okay. Now, what did I tell you? Write your 1 by N as a dx, write your R by N as an x. So it is as good as you are trying to solve this question. Summation process will become an integration process. And when R is 1, X is 0. And when R is N, X is 1. So it is as good as integrating this. Correct? Now, 1 by 1 plus X into 1 plus 2X. I can solve this by partial fraction here. So as a partial fraction, can I write it like this? Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So integration of 1 by 1 plus x, 1 plus 2x dx is as good as integrating this. Zero to one. Will be ln 1 plus 2x. Please note that 2 and 2 will get cancelled. So this will become ln 3 by 2. 0 will give me ln 1, which is 0 itself. So the answer is ln 3 by 2. Is this fine? So this limit problem basically gives you a result, which is in terms of ln. It comes out to be in natural log. Clear? Idea clear? Don't worry, we'll take at least two more problems before we, you know, close this chapter. By the way, in your normal classes that we have on Thursday for R&R and Friday for the non-R&R people, I'll be starting with differential equations. Okay. Next question. Evaluate whole to the power of 1 by n and this whole thing divided by n. N plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 3 all the way till 2n. The product is raised to the power of 1 by n and whole is divided by n. N is tending to infinity. See, right now it is not limit of a sum, okay? So there's a limit of a product, right? So you have to take log somewhere to convert product to a sum. So you can start, you can take this as a hint and start with the problem. So first step, as I already told you, so even before that, you can do one small change in the way the question has been written. Include this n within this nth power or nth root. So you can write it like this. You can introduce it as n to the power n, okay? And take this 1 by n power outside the whole thing, okay? And one more thing we can do here. We can impart these nn's to each of these factors. So something like this. Okay. Now let's call this as L and take the limit, take the log to the base here on both the sides. Remember, log can enter the limit. Okay, so that will make it log of n plus 1 by n plus log of n plus 2 by n plus. Please note that all of them are to the base of e. This is n plus n by n. Okay. Now think as if this is the limit of a sum. Or this is a series to infinite terms that we need to sum up. So write down the rth term of this that is going to be ln of n plus r by n. Okay. In fact, one very small error that we had done is basically this will become 1 by n over here. If you take a log, that thing is going to come down first, isn't it? Now here, already things have been written in such a way that not only 1 by n has got segregated, but it has also converted the remaining part as a function of r by n. Okay. So this is going to behave as your dx. And this part is going to be ln 1 plus x. Okay. Sorry for writing dx before, but this is the rough cut that we had learned. So you are integrating it. Now remember, you are going from r equal to 1 till r equal to n. So r equal to 1 will give you lower limit as 0 and r equal to n will give you upper limit as 1, right? So whatever answer comes out, that is the answer of limit log to the base of e. I think that's right, Kshitij. Okay, that should be the answer. So here we can use our integration by parts. So let's take this as our first function, take this as our second function. So it's ln 1 plus x into x minus 1 by 1 plus x into x dx. This is your ln of n. Okay. This I can write it as x plus 1 minus 1. So it's 1 by 1. Now note that on putting a 1, you'll end up getting 1 ln 2, which is ln 2. And putting a 0 will give everything 0. And here I will end up getting x minus ln 1 plus x 0 to 1. So when you put a 1, you get 1 minus ln 2. And when you put a 0, I think everything will become a 0. So that's nothing but 2 ln 2 minus 1. In short, I can write it as ln 4 minus ln e, which is ln of 4 by e. So note that this result is ln of the limit. Ln of the limit is ln of 4 by e. So L becomes 4 by e. This is your answer. So I think only Kshitij got this result. Is it clear? So this is one of the very good problems that you may get in your competitive exams. Okay. So not only you are converting it as a limit of a sum by taking a log, you are also integrating it by parts. Okay. So many concepts are getting tested. So please give importance to this multi-conceptual problems. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Please highlight. So with this, we are going to take a last problem for the entire chapter. And next class, as I already told you, I'm going to start with ordinary differential equations, ODE. So let's take this question. Evaluate limit n tending to infinity, summation of r square from r equal to 1 till n into summation of r cube, again r going to 1 till n, by summation of r to the power 6, r going from 1 to n. Very good, Vaibhav. Anybody else? I mean, they have written it in a very straightforward manner. So I don't think so there is a problem in addressing it. Okay, let's discuss this out. So my purpose would be to generate a 1 by n and functions of R by N. So can I write the first summation as R by N the whole square? And of course, I have to have an N square to compensate for it. Second summation, multiply with N cube, R by N the whole cube, R going from 1 to N. And down in the denominator also, R by N to the power 6 into N to the power 6, R going from 1 to N. Okay. Now, this expression will, you know, so, you know, beautifully, you know, take care of each other. See here, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to divide with N to the power 7. Okay. N to the power 7, I'll split this up as N cube here and N to the power 4 over here. So this automatically becomes 1 by N summation of R by N the whole square from R equal to 1 till N. And of course, your limit on N is infinity. That I forgot writing here. Limit of N is infinity. Similarly, here I'll end up getting 1 by N summation R by N whole cube, R going from 1 to N. And down in the denominator, I have 1 by N summation R by N to the power 6, R going from 1 to N. Now, time has come that we write these as a definite integral. So this entire thing becomes integration of x square from 0 to 1. Correct me if I'm wrong. So 1 by N behaves as your dx. R by N whole square is x square. R is going from 1 to N means x is going from 0 to 1. Okay. Similarly, the other one is 0 to 1 x cube dx. And denominator is 0 to 1 x to the power 6 dx. So this integration is x cube from 0 to 1, which is 1 by 3. This is x to the power 4 by 4, which is 1 by 4. This is x to the power 7 by 7, which is 1 by 7. Answer is 7 upon 12. Okay. Any questions, any concerns with respect to this? So next class, as I told you, I'll be starting with differential equations. And it would be my effort to complete this before your KVPY session. Exactly, Aditya. Had we known the expansion of, had we known the summation of sixth power of natural numbers, you could have used that also to solve it. But unfortunately, we have not derived till that extent. That is why this method was helpful. Okay. So it's not that if you know your definite integrals, you can, or you may not be, it is because you could not use your summation process. No. Definite integral can also help you where your summation process will also work or might also work, but it is, its domain is much wider. It can be used to solve even when your summation is not working out, when your summation formulas are not there. Okay. Thank you, class. Bye-bye. Take care. All the best for any exams that you have. And I think tomorrow your schools are also reopening. So please complete your pending work. Thank you. Bye-bye. Evening, you have a chemistry class. Okay. I think message would have already gone. Let me just check.